FDIC, how you will lose your entire life savings. I'm going to explain this to you in three simple, fast steps, but don't worry, at the end of the video, I'm going to give you a solution for this problem. Step number one, we need to understand how the relationship with you and your savings and your bank actually works. Obviously, you're a big fan of the channel because you're holding a sign that says end the Fed. But the problem, and I get this question all the time, people ask me, George, where should I put my savings? So we're going to answer that for you right now on this video. You've got excess production. Most people call that savings. You need to put that into your bank. So your bank gives you a few different options. They say you can put it into this checking account, and that's paying a 0.000001% interest rate. And although that is an estimation, that's probably a high estimation. Or you can put it into the savings account that's paying 0.3%. And you look at that and say, man, those interest rates are terrible. I don't want anything to do with that. I might as well just put the money under my mattress. But the bank says, hey, well, we've got a couple more options that you may just like. A certificate of deposit or CD or a money market account. This CD is paying 2.2%, and this money market account, which has a little bit more flexibility, is paying 2%. And this really kind of jives with what we're seeing online right now. Editor, let's go over to the website NerdWallet, and that will pull up some rates for CDs right now in December 2019. And you'll see that the very first option is a CD that's paying 2.05%. Not bad. And that's from a company called Marcus. Wow, Marcus, that sounds really super safe. But we look at the fine print and we see, oh, it's not really Marcus. That's Goldman Sachs. So first and foremost, we've got a big red flag right there, but let's put that on the shelf for a moment. Now let's get into why banks want your deposits in the first place. If we look at the banking business model, we know that they borrow short, lend long. So they're in the business of lending, and they have to have reserves as a percentage of how much money they actually lend out. Now, to be clear, they don't usually lend out the money that you have in your checking account and your savings account, but they do require reserves. So a cheap way to get those reserves is through a checking account that they're only having to pay you 0.000001%. The other option is to go into the US dollar funding market. And if you don't know what that is, no problem. We're going to get into that in a moment. But there, they'd probably have to pay 1.5% for those reserves. So if you're the head of this bank, which one would you choose? Well, it's a no-brainer. You want those deposits in the form of checking accounts because that's super, super cheap money that you can use as reserves against the amount of money that you're lending out. So now we understand why banks want your money, but it still doesn't answer our main question of the video, and that's how on earth can a bank afford to pay you 2.2% on a CD or 2% on a money market account, when on a checking account, they're only paying you 0.000001%, or on a savings account, 0.3%. That doesn't make any sense at all. To find out a little bit more, let's go back to Investopedia. A money market account is a type of mutual fund that invests in very short-term interest-bearing instruments to generate a variable yield while preserving principal. And to be clear, a money market account isn't necessarily a money market fund. Those can be two separate things. But this really starts to take us down the rabbit hole. And I challenge you, when this video is done, to do a Google search of certificates of deposit or money market accounts and try to figure out how the banks are investing that money to actually give you that higher return. And most likely, the only thing that you'll find is not how they invest, but how safe they are because they're FDIC insured. Step number two, the US dollar funding market. In step number one, we've established that most people save in a CD or a money market account or money market fund sometimes. So the question then becomes, how do these CDs or money markets pay such a high rate of interest compared to a normal savings account or checking account? To do this, we need to pull back the kimono of the actual banks. When you go to a bank, you see this really super safe structure to store your money. It's just a model of prudence. But the reality is a lot different than it may seem at first glance. Editor, go ahead and pull back that kimono. Let's look behind the curtain and see what the US banking system looks like behind the scenes. This is a diagram from the New York Fed's website, and it shows us exactly what the banks could potentially be doing with your money. If we look at the transaction types on the left-hand side, these are all of our options. Now, some of them don't really apply, so we can cross them off the list, but there are five main categories or five options for these banks to make money on your money. The first option is commercial paper. This is just a short-term loan, usually under a year, to a corporation. And the cool thing about this diagram is we can see exactly where the money flows. The Federal Reserve's on the left, onshore entities in the middle, offshore entities on the right. These green arrows show us where the money is flowing. I want to point out with the onshore investors, the money is flowing into corporates. Well, that makes a lot of sense, but it's coming from what? Prime money market funds. To be clear, there is a difference between a money market account and a money market fund, but there is a gray area there and it gets really murky, especially when we consider the definition that Investopedia gave us, that money market accounts are a type of money market funds. But I don't think that the commercial paper is the culprit. In other words, I don't think that your bank is lending your money to corporations on a short-term basis to get that 2%. Why do I say that? Because right now, if we look at the going interest rate for commercial paper, editor, go ahead and pull that up really quick, we can see that it's 1.62%. So the bank would be taking a loss if they're making 1.62% to pay you 2% plus. The next option would be euro dollar lending. This is where the prime money market funds lend dollars to foreign banks like Deutsche Bank, so they can take those dollars and use them as reserves to create more dollar loans. Not exactly the safest place for your life savings. If we pull up the euro dollar future market, editor, go ahead and do that right now, we can see that the current lending rate, or at least for January of 2020, is 1.82%. This is below the 2% that the bank is promising for CDs and money markets, so I think that we can cross this one off the list as well. Next, we've got the purchase of U.S. debt from the Treasury. This is pretty straightforward, assuming that the Fed's not doing quantitative easing, which they most likely will be. But it just goes from the banks and the dealers, the onshore investors, pretty much everyone involved buying debt from the Treasury. Currently, one-year U.S. debt is yielding 1.53%, so we can cross that one off the list as well. So let's go ahead and cross off one, two, and three. Next, we've got everybody's favorite market, the repo market. Let's go back to the diagram. Pretty much everyone involved is part of the repo market. The banks, the dealers, the offshore entities, the onshore investors, and even Fannie and Freddie. The only group not listed here, of course, is the Federal Reserve, which we know now is almost 100% of the repo market. The current repo rate, and editor, let's go ahead and throw that up on the New York Fed's website, is 1.5%. So we can go ahead and cross them off the list. Lastly is the FX swaps market. And if you guys don't know what that is, make sure you go back and watch my video on Zoltan Pozar after you watch this video. What's interesting here is this is the first diagram that we've seen where the US banks actually have money flows going out to invest in other entities. And here we can see they're investing in foreign insurers and other money managers. Now it gets really interesting. We put on our detective hat and we can cross these off the list, not only because the numbers don't make sense, but on that diagram, it never showed money flows from the banks to these other markets where they could get a return. The only market that showed money flow coming from the banks was the FX swap market. So the next question would become, can the banks get a higher return in the FX swap market than they're promising in the CDs and the money market account at 2%? Currently, the banks are getting LIBOR plus X. X is whatever they charge. So what is the LIBOR rate? Editor, give me a drum roll, please. The current LIBOR rate is 2%. You probably could have guessed that. So that means that your bank is possibly taking your money and lending it to a foreign entity in the FX swap market, and that entity most likely is systemically connected to who? Deutsche Bank. Step number three, insert the FDIC. And you could have watched that last segment and said, yeah, George, but does this really matter? If the bank's gambling with my life savings, I mean, who really cares? Because it's FDIC insured, up to $250,000. But I'd like to remind you that the FDIC is not the first insurance corporation that we've had insuring deposits. Let's not forget about the FSLIC. And you may be saying, well, I don't really remember that. What does that stand for? Let me spell it out for you. Federal Savings Loan Insurance Corporation. Remember the S&L crisis, where they went completely bust to the tune of $150 billion. And now they've merged into the FDIC. The FDIC currently only has $25 billion in their fund. You think that may be a lot, but it's to insure $9 trillion worth of deposits. And you say, yeah, George, but it's been working so far and I'm not too worried about it. Remember in 2009, because of the great financial crisis, the fund dropped all the way down to $0.648 billion. That's $648 million. They almost went bust. And the last version of the FDIC required a $150 billion bailout. Now they've only got $25 billion, which I'd like to point out is less than 1% of the deposits that they insure. If you are one of the Americans that's putting your confidence and your hard-earned savings in the care of the FDIC, it's the exact same as doing it with Lehman Brothers when they were selling insurance in the form of credit default swaps to insure the mortgage-backed securities. And that's why I say putting confidence in the FDIC is how you will lose your entire life savings. Oh, but wait, there is more. I did say at the end of the video, I would give you a solution. And my solution to this problem is take your savings and put it into T-bills. Treasuries, probably the last thing that you would think I would say. But if you take your money, put it into T-bills to keep that powder dry, maybe 3 months, 6 months, and continue to roll it over, you're getting a decent interest rate, and your counterparty is the government. And at the end of the day, we know they can print the money to make you whole. For more information on these topics, check out this content right here, and I will see you on the next video.